Hey y'all, I'm William Beckman, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Real Life, Real Music Radio, with your host, Kyle Hutton.
How you been doing, buddy?
Good, man, good. We didn't have, my band and I, we're all here, and we didn't have any problems getting here because we got here 2 days early. We've been here since Monday. We thought it was a good idea to get here early. We spent the first two nights sleeping in an RV park in our Sprinter van. So yeah, we've been roughing it out, but we're excited that the festival's finally kicking off.
Yeah, well, we're glad you're here. And gosh, in some ways, it seems like yesterday that you and I sat on this stage and had this conversation, but it's actually been a long time.
2 years.
Because we missed last year.
That's right.
And a lot's going on for you in the last 2 years.
We've been busy. We've been very blessed and fortunate. So everybody in my camp, we're very, very excited and grateful.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, we're going to hear about some of the stuff that's been going on with you, but why don't you just pick out a song that you know these folks came to hear tonight?
All right.
Just give us something to kick the night off with.
Cool. I'll start off with this song. This is one of my favorite songs that I've ever written. I'm a big fan of traditional country music, old school stuff. I was living in, I moved to Nashville. I'm 26 years old and I moved to Nashville when I was 19. And when I got there, I met so many different songwriters that were, they were all writing music and people that were my age. And we'd do writer's rounds, which I'm sure you know what that is. And it's, you're on stage like this and you kind of take turns singing songs. And it's always interesting because you don't know the people that you're sitting next to and you never heard their songs before, but everybody was always singing like really great progressive, country songs. And down a dirt road in my pickup truck, gonna get down, gonna mess you up, that kind of stuff. And I'm like, wow, that's really interesting. nothing bad about it, but it was just, that was, you know, so I was like, man, I'm gonna try to write a song that I think encompasses country music. And I remember at the time I went through a big vinyl phase. I was living in Austin, Texas, and I'd collect a bunch of vinyl records, and a lot of the records that I collected were old traditional country records, like, of course, Hank Sr. and George Jones, but even people like Little Jimmy Dickens and that kind of stuff, and Hank Snow, and I noticed that all those songs, all those guys were either writing about their girl walking out on them or getting drunk, and so I figured I'd write a song about both of those things. I wrote this song called Bourbon Whiskey. Well, you said it's over, our love is dead and gone. I don't know where it went wrong, but honey, I won't complain if you decide to leave. So go on, walk out that door, and don't worry about me. I will be drinking bourbon whiskey all night long with my friends to keep me company. And darling, mind at all, because I'll be busy drinking bourbon whiskey. Pack your belongings and go back to Cleveland. Forget about me and enjoy your freedom. Just don't call me to say you're sorry and you miss me, because I won't listen. No,
I'll be drunk off bourbon whiskey. Ain't that right now? I will be drinking bourbon whiskey all night long with my friends to keep me company. And darling, you won't be on my mind at all. No, you won't, because I'll be busy drinking bourbon whiskey.
Because, you know, we've done this show before.
Yeah.
And so in the radio business, you know, you mix stuff and you put shows together, and that means you get to hear it a lot. I can't help but, like, I get this big old grin when this kid starts singing over here, because it sounds like stuff that used to come out of my granddaddy's old radio.
But he's 26
years old, and he's sitting right here. It's just crazy. It's crazy to me. You know what I mean? Which is awesome. So, okay. And I'm just going to say this, like, right up front. Two of like the most distinct voices that I really love have come from Del Rio, Texas. And one of them is you, and one of them is a guy by the name of Radney Foster.
That's right, yeah.
And just amazing country voices. Now, I know you and Radney have spent some time together, and I think you would call him a mentor and
a
friend. But tell me,
and I'm a big fan of the record that y'all did together, by the way.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you very much. What is it about that mix of, you know, the Latin influence and the old country music influence? Just try to let us into your head a little bit on what makes you sound the way you sound.
Well, a lot of it, vocally speaking, from a singer standpoint, like, I remember when I was growing up, I was listening to a lot of mariachi music, and we just lost the greatest mariachi singer of all time. His name is Vicente Fernandez, and I grew up listening to his records, you know, and a lot of it's got like a like an opera background. It's just a very healthy way to sing, you know, from your diaphragm and stuff. So when I was learning how to sing, it was trying to mimic that, really, honestly. And then, of course, you incorporate the country thing and some of the great singers, like Merle Haggard and people that were singing in similar styles or whatever, Marty Robbins. I'm a huge Rat Pack fan, you know, Sinatra and all. So I was like, it was weird, like, when I was growing up, I think everybody else was like listening to Eminem, and I was listening to Sinatra. But no, seriously, I mean, I would just listen to those records and try to figure out what it was that I liked about the way they were singing, and then try to break it down and incorporate it to what I like to do. So a lot of it was like Dean Martin, Sinatra, and, as you know, at the same time, I was listening to Randy Rogers Band and you know, Pat Green, and a lot of stuff that was coming out of Texas. So I think a lot of it was just trying to learn as much as I could, because I didn't come from a musical family. I didn't have anybody that was able to teach me how to play guitar or teach me how to sing. So the only way I knew how to do it was to listen to records and then watch YouTube videos. That was when YouTube was first kind of a thing. That was before you had commercials on YouTube, by the way. You remember that? When you didn't have that, that was really cool. And I just learned how to play songs doing it like that. And of course, Radney came into my life when I was in high school. So he was the one that really got me into the songwriting aspect of what I do. But but before then, I was just, you know, singing George Strait songs and Sinatra songs.
Okay. Well, here's the thing. I know we're here to hear your music, but I want to ask for a little experiment here and put you on the spot. If you can't do it, that's totally fine. But could you give us a taste of the Hispanic influence, and then give us a taste of like that Rat Pack influence?
Yeah,
if you cover anything from those two genres.
Okay. Yeah, we can do that.
Let's
see. We can do a little piece. Can I do a slow one for you? Actually, I'll do this one. This is a Pepe Aguilar song, which is another one of my favorite mariachi singers.
Estoy acobardando y lo he notado, y eso no es muy bueno para mí. Si quiero retenerla entre mis brazos, será mejor que no me vea sufrir. Estoy estacionado en los fracasos y hoy voy a remediar la situación. ¿Será que siempre ha dado demasiado? En el exceso siempre salgo dañado. Por mujeres como tú, amor, hay hombres como yo que se pueden morir por dignidad, mordiendo el corazón. Por mujeres como tú, amor, hay hombres como yo, sé que se pueden perder en el alcohol, mordiendo el corazón. Yeah.
Okay, now take us to the other side. Take us to the mafia side.
The mafia side of things.
Influence.
Well, you know, I won't even play the guitar because I don't know the chords to it. But like, when I was talking about like the way those guys used to sing. Like I remember listening to Sinatra, and he had such a very big, deep, powerful voice with a really kind of a slower vibrato, and so he would, you know, sing like, "Now the end is near, so I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain." And he always, you know, like he would do those things where like he would cross every T, like, you know, in Texas, in which I'm certain, you know, but like he would, you know, in which I'm certain,
right?
Things like that, yeah. You know, and then like Dean Martin was, him and Elvis had like a similar style of singing, which it was very, you like, this is really boring, I'm sure, but like you drop your larynx down and it allows you to have a very quick vibrato, and it's kind of wistful almost. And it's like, the sun is sinking in the west, the cattle go down to the stream, the red wing settles in the nest, it's time for a cowboy to dream. Purple lights in the canyon, that's where I long to be.
with my three good companions, just my rifle, pony, and me. You know, that kind of. So it's, you know, it was a.
That's great. That's awesome.
It was a process to learn how to do all that stuff. But, it, you know, and those little nuances of things is things that I incorporate into my own voice. And so, yeah, that's the Rat Pack kind of stuff that I used to heavily listen to when I was a kid. You know.
That's really cool. That's really cool. And the cool thing is too, to see that through artists like you, in your generation, that you're gonna help carry that forward.
Well, I appreciate
that's an important
that. Yeah.
Part of our culture.
Well, you know, I think so too. Yeah, you know, I love. I tell people, you know, I love all kinds of music. You know, I can appreciate. I can appreciate all kinds of music. It doesn't, and that's a cool thing about it. Is like, even if something's not your cup of tea, I think it's really important for you to take the time to like sit down and appreciate it for what it is. You know.
Yeah.
Just like anything, you know. If you don't like Brussels sprouts, it doesn't mean you have to eat it, but you know, somebody else likes it, doesn't mean they're wrong for liking that. Does that make sense? You know, it's like you have to, I always tell people that your musical palate is something that's ever evolving and you have to be conscious of that. I'm really excited to have my new bass player that's playing with me and my monitor guy too. They're big metal heads, you know? So we're driving down the road and we're listening to metal. I'm like, I don't listen to this shit, you know, but it's cool. It's cool. I dig it. You know, it's like, I think it's cool when you can appreciate something for what it is, even though it's not something that you're accustomed to. And I try to live my life that way when it comes to music. So.
Yeah, gotcha. Back on the Brussels sprout thing, I think as long as they've got bacon and some brown sugar.
I love Brussels sprouts, by the way. Just throwing that out there.
All right, so I've taken you back to the past and kind of your roots. Let's fast forward. You got anything new you've been working on that maybe we haven't heard yet that you could give us a little, we'll call it a Media Lounge exclusive here.
Yeah, I'll play this song for you. This song's called Damn This Heart of Mine. Heart of mine, it's all busted up and blue. It's taking its sweet time, getting over you. Keeps dancing with your memory, like moonlight on the beach. Holding on for dear life with each and every beat. Damn this heart of mine for making me feel like this old world won't turn and love ain't real. It won't let me let go. It sure won't let me die. Damn this heart of mine. Damn this radio, it keeps driving me insane. It's almost like it knows every song you used to sing. Damn this empty hallway and all the pictures on the wall. Damn every dream we ever lost, but honey, most of all, damn this heart of mine for making me feel like this old world won't turn and love ain't real. It won't let me let go, and it sure won't let me die. Damn this heart of mine. This old world won't turn and love ain't real. It won't let me let go, and it sure won't let me die. Well, damn this heart of mine. Damn this heart of mine.
great tune.
Thank you.
When did you write that one?
I wrote that about a month ago with my buddy Nick Walsh. He's a fantastic. We're both Warner Chapel songwriters, so we wrote that song together. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, we drank a couple beers at the bar, and we're like, "Well, I guess we should get to work." And then, and we wrote a good song, so it worked out for us.
You know, there's not that many jobs anymore where you can get away with that.
Yeah, no.
Bar,
well,
drink some beer and then go to work.
Well, the cool thing about having a publishing deal like that is, like, so many of the writers that I write with up in Nashville are friends of mine. So if we're supposed to meet up at 11, I'll just text them like, "Hey, man, like, does 2 o'clock sound better to you? Because that sounds better to me." And they're like, "All right, well, you want to meet up at the bar and, like, drink a couple of beers?" Like, "Yeah, let's do that. We'll talk about some ideas." The thing is, you got to be careful, because there's been times where it's like 8 o'clock at night. Like, "Oh, wait, we were supposed to write a song today." And we just tab out at the bar, like, "Let's try this again tomorrow." But that was a good day for us. So,
all right. So from Del Rio, Texas. Now, are you living in Nashville now?
I moved to Nashville when I was, when I was 19 or 20. Okay. I went to college for 2 years at St. Edward's University in Austin, and then I transferred over to Belmont University up in Nashville. So in 2015 is when I moved there, and I've kept a place there ever since. So I tour mostly in Texas, but whenever I have to go up there to write songs, I just have my own place, and it's pretty nice.
Gotcha. Okay, so talk about touring in Texas. I want to ask you about two shows specifically.
Mm-hmm.
First, the outdoor stage here at Music Fest.
Earlier today?
Yeah.
It was awesome.
Tell me about it.
My band and I, we felt really good about it. We had a good time. You know, it's one of those things. As a guitar player, you play so much guitar that, you know, the muscle memory kicks in. But I'll tell you what, man, it's a bizarre feeling playing guitar and looking at your fingers. You're like, "I can't feel a thing." I hope I'm playing a G chord, because that's what it looks like I'm playing, but I'm not quite sure. But it was awesome, man. We had a good time. We were all a little numb from the weather, but it was fun. And if y'all came to that show, thank you so much for sticking it out with us, because there's no higher compliment than standing in the sleet and the snow and watching a band play. So thank you.
That's awesome. And another show that I know you got to participate in recently with your buddy Parker McCollum,
mm-hmm.
Was a pretty big show for you. Tell us about that one.
We did. If you're referring to the ones we did a couple of days ago, we did the Paycom Center in Oklahoma City, and then a couple of days after that, we did the AT&T Center in San Antonio.
Yeah,
that was a lot of fun. It's kind of crazy to be like, "Oh, there's people down here, and there's people way up there, and there's people way over there, and there's people backstage." It's crazy. There's people all around. Go Spurs, go. That's right.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, we're excited for you, and I think I can probably say for everybody in this room tonight, we like that you got to go play those big shows, but we like that you're sitting in here with us tonight.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because this is a fun way to hear a show. So play another song. You just pick us another.
Yeah,
pick another one you want to play for us.
Let me play this song. It's one that'll be on the next record as well. And this is actually Radney's, one of his favorite songs that I do.
Awesome.
And growing up in Del Rio, the town that borders Del Rio is Acuna, and there's a famous bar down there called the Corona Club, and a lot of people know it from going back there, and they're, you know, back in the day, or the Desperado movie. And I wrote this song about that place. Just a waltz. It tells a story about falling in love down in Mexico, and it's a cool. We don't have very many waltzes in our sets, but this is one that we do, and the song's called "Danced All Night Long." In the Mexican town of Acuna, Coahuila, I was down at the bar drinking beer and tequila. It was then when I saw the most beautiful señorita walk on through the door. She had a pretty red dress on and a rose in her hair. Every man in the room could not help but stare. I was convinced it was love at first sight, I swear. I knew I'd have to ask her to dance. So we danced all night long. We romanced, song after song. Yeah, we danced
after song. We danced all night long. She asked me como te llamas. And I told her my name. She said es un gusto conocerte. And I told her the same. I guess George Strait was right when he said Mexico's to blame, 'cause this woman stole my heart right out my chest. When we danced all night long. We romanced, song after song. We danced all night long. Song. We danced all night long. Well, as each song played, we held each other close. Still, we danced and we danced till the bar had to close. I looked down at her and said, come on, babe, vamanos. And the two of us walked away hand in hand. After we danced all night long. We romanced, song after song.
Y'all ready now?
Y nos enamoramos con cada canción, song after song. We danced all night long.
Do you ever dance?
Yeah. So my next question is, has anybody ever twerked on that song before?
No, but thank you for that,
that
sir.
That was pretty impressive,
that
sir.
That was amazing.
That was pretty good.
Thank you for wearing my shirt, too. I appreciate that.
Are y'all having a good time so far? Is everybody doing okay in here tonight? Okay. If you're late to the party, welcome to the Music Fest Media Lounge. And we've got Mr. William Beckman right here. I'm glad.
I'm glad too. Thank you. Thank y'all for having me. Thank y'all for being here.
All right. Well, where do you want to take us next?
Let's see.
Tell us a story.
I can tell you a story. Brackettville, Texas is a small little town, exactly 30 miles away from Del Rio. And every time I go home to see my parents, I'm always driving through these small towns. And I always think about like growing up in a small town and kind of having, these different love stories come to mind. And I think about these, I came up with this story, these two characters that fell in love with each other, but they live a town away from each other. And so they kind of go commute every night to go see each other. And I wrote this song called 30 Miles. But it's one of those story songs I think it's just a really cool story, and this is actually one of Radney's favorite songs too. I don't know if every time I show Radney songs, like, man, I love that, man. He's like, that's one of my favorite ones. I was like, are you just saying that or no? No, that's a lie, because he will tell me if something needs to be corrected.
Yes, he will.
This song's called 30 Miles.
There's 30 miles between you and I, but I'll still meet you in the dead of night. And I'll drive right through that uneasy rain if it means I'll get to see your face again. And if you sing your favorite melody, you'll keep me in this dream I'm living in. Go ahead and laugh at me. Tell me how you think I'm innocent. And I'll tell you how I think your heart is wild. Well, no one has to know about us. These towns are way too small to trust. So lock me away inside your room and we can do whatever we want to. And if you sing your favorite melody, you'll keep me in this dream I'm living in. Go ahead and laugh at me. Tell me how you think I'm innocent. I'll tell you how I think your heart is wild. And I don't wanna go back to the town where I belong. I wanna stay with you till dawn and listen to you sing that same old song. It goes like da 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 da. There used to be 30 miles between you and I, but then you moved away and we had to say goodbye. It broke my heart in so many ways. I often find myself looking back on the days when you sing your favorite melody. Oh, what a beautiful dream that I was living in. Now I miss you making fun of me by telling me you thought that I was innocent. I told you how I thought your heart was wild. Oh, I miss those 30 miles. It's 30 miles on.
Man.
Thank you.
It's a great song.
Thank you. I gotta tell you, I'm sweating bullets. You know how hard it is to sing with Sundance Head right behind you, like watching your every move? He is the best singer I've ever met, and so I'm doing my best, man.
how you doing, Sundance?
Doing all right?
Good to see you.
No pressure.
Man, I love you, brother, man.
Okay, so you talked about songs coming out on a new project.
Mm-hmm.
Give us an update on where we are with that.
Yeah, so we're really excited. I've got this this batch of songs that I've had for a while, and we've been wanting to record it, and we finally got around to it. And my producer, his name's Oren Thornton. He's amazing, he's also produced Caitlin Butt's new record.
Yeah.
Thank you for being here, Caitlin. But no, he's awesome, and he's got great ideas, and I'm so I feel very blessed to get to work with somebody that just sees eye to eye with what I want, and he always makes sure not to get too far in the way of what it is that I want. So he's great, and it'll be a 7-song EP, and but yeah, a lot of these songs that I've played will be on that record.
And you've played us a couple of them so far.
Yeah, right? Yeah, I've played a couple
you
of them.
Play us some more.
Yeah, for sure.
Am I going to get in trouble?
No, not at all. No, this is to promote the record. So hopefully listen to it whenever it comes out.
And let me, you know what I didn't tell y'all at the very beginning of the show that I want to remind you? I've got microphones to my right and left pointed out at you guys. And they're designed that when it's time to be loud, like when he does something really awesome and plays a great song, we want you guys to go nuts. And then like when he's talking or when he's singing, we want you to be quiet. Otherwise, everybody on our syndicated network is going to hear that you needed another Deep Eddy with Ruby Red. And, you know, it's just, you know, we know you need one. Just go back there quietly and get it. She's holding one up back there. She's got it ready for you. This is perfect. Okay. But thank you, guys. You're being a great audience. But just remember, you are mic'd, okay? Now back to our regularly scheduled program.
It's probably one of my favorite songs. It was probably my favorite song off of the record. And we put it out a while back and filmed a really cool music video in Del Rio for it. Song's called In the Dark.
Thank you.
Where'd you go, baby? How'd you disappear? Did you go looking for freedom in some town far away from here? 'Cause I can see you in the distance of a faded memory. I should've known you had your fingers crossed every time you said that you loved me. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart? Well, there's whiskey in the bottle, but it won't be there for long. If I keep asking all these questions, wondering if I did something wrong, now I'm locked up in our bedroom like a prisoner in a cell. Spend too much time thinking about you, too many nights going through hell. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart? 'Cause I still love you. Oh, what a foolish thing to say, 'cause I'm sure I have not crossed your mind in at least 100 days. Oh, but I just want you light my world up once again. I can't accept the fact that you and I have reached the end. Now I wish I would have known you were gonna leave me feeling blue. Makes me wonder why I ever wasted all my time loving you. Now I can't find a single answer, 'cause you left me in the dark. How am I supposed to carry onward? What am I supposed to tell my heart now? Where'd you go, baby? How'd you disappear? Did you go looking for freedom now in some town far away from here?
Nice.
Thank you.
Man, you know, another, I just figured out another reason that I love sitting here listening to you sing, not from a comparison perspective, but just how listening to you sing makes me feel. When I was a kid, my dad had all of the early Glen Campbell records.
Wow. A huge fan of Glen Campbell.
Yeah, man. And just, I don't know. There's just something about the quality of your voice.
Well, thank you.
Takes me back to that.
Yeah, thank you. That means a lot to me. And as a matter of fact, I was just in Cabo. We were doing the songwriting festival down there, and Ashley Campbell was on that festival too. And her and I got to know each other, and her, obviously, you know, when your dad's Glen Campbell, it's big shoes to fill. But she is one of the most talented musicians. She plays the banjo like nobody's business,
wow.
Plays the guitar like her dad, sings like an angel, and writes like nobody I've ever heard. So if you ever get the chance to check out Ashley's music, it's amazing. But we were sitting there talking. She loves talking about her dad and telling stories and stuff. And, you know, speaking of Sinatra, not a lot of people know that Glen Campbell played on I think it was Strangers in the Night. Strangers in the night,
wow.
Exchanging glances, lovers at first sight. What were the chances we'd be sharing love before the night was through?
Yeah. Yeah.
Something in her eyes was so exciting. Sorry. Anyway.
Yeah.
But anyway, she's great. She's great. I'm a big Glen Campbell fan, so thank you for
that. That's awesome. That's awesome. Okay, so let's go to the EP you released in 2018, Outskirts of Town.
Yeah.
And I want to ask you, tell us about the song and play I Want to See You Tonight.
Yeah, I Want to See You Tonight. That's a song that I definitely was trying to rip Radney off on that. It's got a really, really 90s country thing to it. I haven't played that song in a long time, but I can do my best to play it for you. Let me tune this really quick, folks. It's going to be a whole lot better if I do that. But, you know, going back to Radney, he did produce one song off of that EP, and it's the last song on it. It's called Leaving Town, which if we have time, I'd like to play that song for you, too.
Yeah. Thanks for letting me put you on the spot.
Oh, yeah, no. You're keeping me on my toes, man. Keeping me sharp.
Good.
Roy Orbison.
That's a thank you. Except I don't. Do I have sunglasses somewhere? I don't have the glasses to.
So Leaving Town. Tell us about that one.
That one's another kind of like small town, growing up in a small town. That's all I ever knew, you know, is Del Rio. And so when I was first learning how to write songs, that's all I really kind of wrote about. And Leaving Town just kind of tells the story of this individual who wants to be a singer and a songwriter and wants to tour the world. And it's kind of hard to get settled down and to love somebody and stay in a small town. And I wrote this song about it, and I really like the line in the chorus. It says the highway can be dangerous, but they say that it can be just as deadly to settle down. So I think there's a lot of truth in that. Let me see if I've got the correct harmonica.
Y'all doing all right out there?
Yeah.
All right, good.
Let's see.
Better than ever.
Thank you.
Better than ever. That's pretty good.
Other than Radney,
who's your mentor?
Yeah, Radney's the bomb.com. Let me see.
You want to come sit up here? I'll just switch seats. You do that.
Let's see.
I always say I got the best seat in the house, but you got like the second or third best seat in the house. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm still learning how to do this. I had a harmonica player, but we lost him in Denver. Just can't stick around. I can't stand the atmosphere in this town. It brings me down. So I loaded up the truck with gasoline. Now that I've loaded up my stuff, it's time for me to chase a couple dreams before they rust and turn into red dust. The highway can be dangerous, I know, but it can be just as deadly to settle down. I'll let you know if my mind changes, baby. But for now, I'm leaving town. The past couple nights, I've stayed up drinking. I guess I've been depressed, 'cause I'm sure you must be thinking that I'm selfish for leaving you alone like this. But this here guitar that I carry with me, she's the one you need to blame. She gets jealous when you kiss me. That's why I can't stay. She's making me go away. The highway can be dangerous, I know. It can be just as deadly to settle down. I'll let you know if my mind changes, baby. But for now, I'm leaving town. Commitment can be dangerous, but they say that it can be just as deadly to take a vow. I'll let you know if my heart changes, baby. But for now, I'm leaving town.
I know this ain't what you wanna hear, but I'm afraid I just can't stick around.
Very nice. Yeah. Man, that was awesome. Okay, so I think everybody in here is pretty warmed up at this point.
I hope so.
And we need to get a liner to kick off the radio broadcast and the video podcast with. Okay. So
I'm terrible at these, but I'll do my best.
Your line is, I'm William Beckman, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Real Life, Real Music.
Yes.
That might help. This is Real Life, Real Music.
Yep. This is William Beckman, and this is Real Life, Real Music. And then I need you guys to just go nuts, okay, for about... I'll cut you off when I'm ready to for you to cut off, okay? I know this crowd can do. They've been waiting for this all night. I can feel it.
Hey, y'all. I'm William Beckman, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Sit down.
Okay, I didn't know if that was the end or not.
I said it was a liner, not the outro. You're not getting out of here that easy, man. No way. Okay.
Johnny Rodriguez.
Yeah.
Ooh. Vicente. I don't know any Johnny Rod. I need to learn some, but I can do Vicente for sure.
So bring us back to the new project.
Okay.
You got anything else you want to play us as a preview off of the new record?
Yeah, we got a, let me see.
Y'all okay with new stuff? I love hearing all this new stuff. Yeah.
This is a song that, this is a song I did not write, is that okay? This is a song that I've gotten to be good buddies with Mr. Eric Pasley up in Nashville, and he played me this song, and I thought it was so catchy and so cool that I decided to cut this song. This is one of his songs. It's called Follow. And your son actually took the photo for the cover of this song. Where is he? He's a song song. Anyway,
he's sitting right over
there.
There
he is. Yeah. Here we go.
good one. I see why you picked that one. That's great. Okay, so when did you, how old were you when you wrote your first, like, complete song?
Probably like 12 or 13.
Okay, gotcha. And did it stay pretty consistent, the writing for you after that?
No, I gave it up for a little while because they were so bad, the songs I was writing. You know, and then Radney was really the one that helped me get into it. Because, you know, when I first met Radney, I was 17 years old, I think, 16 or 17, and I was in high school, and I was, you know, he pretty much said, like, was like, well, what do you want to do? Like, and I was like, well, I want to do what you do. And he's like, well, do you have any of your own songs that you've written? I said, well, not really. He's like, well, you better start writing. And he told me to write 100 songs before he saw me next, because I was still in high school, and I think he was visiting Del Rio for something. He was at the high school for something, and he said that he was going to come back to Del Rio a year later to play a show, and that if I wrote 100 songs, that he'd take me seriously and help me out. So I did. I spent like my whole junior year of high school writing the most god-awful songs you've ever heard in your entire life. And but, you know, he never said they had to be good. He just said you had to write 100. So when I saw him again, he's like, hey, did you write 100 songs? I said, yes, sir, I did. And he said, were any of them good? I said, no. And then, you know, he started laughing. He's like, well, that was the point. You know, the point is to, like, flush out all that stuff. And then, you know, it's just like anything. You do it long enough and then you start to figure out where, like, where you're going wrong or what to avoid when you're writing something. Like, there's this one piece of advice that's always stuck with me that he gave me. I sent him a song and then, like, and I can't remember the song or what it was about or anything, but like, he's like, he, like, he called me on the phone. He's like, hey, you know, second verse, third line, whatever. You're saying the same thing twice. Like, you need to rewrite that. I was like, well, what do you mean? He's like, well, you're saying the same thing twice. It'd be like, you know, an example would be like, if you said, well, I'm all alone and there's nobody here with me. You know, you're just saying the same thing. He's like, make better use of that third line. You know, we already know you're alone. We already know nobody's with you because you just said that you're alone. I was like, oh, I didn't think about that. You know, so stuff like that, you know, like, he taught me how to, like, the potholes to avoid when you're writing a song and how to be a good songwriter. And so, you know, I can't remember how old I was when I wrote my first song, but I remember how old I was when I started to be a confident a songwriter, I guess. And that was well into my college days, you know.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, Leroy Parnell came and did our show at Do-Si-Do the night after he got inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we interviewed him, and I said, man, what advice can you give any aspiring songwriter? And he said, every songwriter's got about 100 bad songs in them, and the quicker you write them, the better off we'll all be.
That's so true.
Well, that's pretty good. That explains a lot.
Yeah, that does. Going back to the bar, whenever you're meeting up with your songwriter buddy, like, let's just call it a day and go drink a beer or something.
Okay, so let's go back to the first song. Do you remember the first song when you thought, okay, I did it, I wrote a good song? Pick one of those early ones that maybe is still in your set list or that you recorded or still play. Just give us one of the early tastes.
Okay. I'll play this one for you. This is a song I wrote for my father. And it's not what you think. It's not going to be like a super sad, like, Dad, I love you, thank you for raising me. Complete opposite. I used to get... My brother and I have an older brother. We'd get in trouble all the time for stealing my dad's liquor from his liquor cabinet. And I still do it to this day. But we'd get in trouble all the time when we were kids. And we'd, like, you know, wait for my parents to go to bed. And then we'd steal a couple bottles of whiskey or whatever, go out to the barn and, you know, throw a little party. And of course, whenever my dad would invite his friends over for drinks or whatever, he'd open up his cabinet and there'd be nothing in there. And but I remember I was 19 when I wrote this song, and it's just a very lengthy song, and I was like, man, this is a pretty clever song. But I sent it to my dad and I said, hey, I wrote you this song about stealing all your whiskey, you know, throughout the years. And he loved the song so much that he sent it to all his friends. And every time they'd have a party and I was there, they'd they'd make me play it. And the funny thing is, like, once I got into college, I'd go and visit my parents, and I'd still steal their booze from the cabinet, and I'd run off back to Austin with it. And my dad would call me halfway through. He's like, "You took something, you know, you took that bottle or whatever." But at that point, it was kind of funny. It was just adding to the legacy of the song. So he wasn't getting mad at me anymore. He was just kind of laughing about it. So my only regret is not having written it sooner. This is a true story.
Did he ever do that to you, by the way? He seems like a good, he seems responsible and like a good, I don't know.
Let me tell you the lesson I had to teach one of my other sons.
Okay.
Okay. We're going to hear the song, but I'm going to tell you a lesson I had to teach one of my other sons. Don't put water in the vodka bottle if it's in the freezer.
Y'all,
because
I've been
when
playing
the vodka
this song.
Is frozen,
I have
know
been playing this
up.
Song for years, and I always have one or two people come up to me after the song, say, "Oh my God, I love that song so much. We used to do the same thing with my dad, but we would drink half the bottle and then fill it back up with water." I said, "No, ma'am, why would you do that? Because you're just wasting the rest of the whiskey." Me and my brother, our philosophy was, we're going to drink the whole thing. We're going to get busted, and then we're just going to be grounded for a couple weeks. We're just going to take the licking. Take the licking. Song's called "Stealing Bottles from My Dad." Well, this here 19-year-old prepubescent went down the street to the 7-Eleven and walked right up to the cashier holding two cold cases of beer. Well, I smiled and gave him my fake ID, and he took one good hard look at me. And he laughed. He said, "Kid, nice try, but not tonight." Well, I got pissed off and I drove out of there, wishing I was older with a little more facial hair, but above all, wishing I had me just a little bit of alcohol. So I sat around thinking what to do, trying to figure out how I could score some booze. And I thought to myself, unfortunately, I'm going to have to go to Plan B. I'm stealing bottles from my dad. No, it's really not that bad. Stealing whiskey, stealing wine, taking whatever I can find. From time to time I've had to steal bottles from my dad. Yes, I have. I've done it once, okay, maybe twice. Hell, who am I kidding? I've done it all my life. But hey, who's counting? No, not me. I'm only five-finger discounting. Don't you worry, Daddy. I'll pay you back when I'm old enough to buy that Tennessee Jack, and I'll restock your entire liquor cabinet with your favorite scotch, Mr. Buchanan's. Lord knows I've stolen at least a dozen over the years, but so has my brother and cousin. We're good kids. I swear we ain't punks. It's just that sometimes we steal to get drunk. But folks, please don't call me a thief or a crook. Oh, yeah, and if you see my dad, tell him not to look in the refrigerator tonight. I'm pretty sure he's all out of Coors Light. I'm stealing bottles from my dad. No, it's really not that bad. Stealing whiskey, stealing wine, taking whatever I can find. From time to time I've had to steal bottles from my dad. Stealing bottles from my dad. No, it's really not that bad. Stealing whiskey, stealing wine, taking whatever I can find. From time to time I've had to steal bottles from my dad, but it ain't that bad. He still loves me, even though I drink his whiskey.
Very nice.
That's an old school song. That's an old one.
Do you have that recorded?
I don't, but I really want to record that song. I'm not sure. Is that a good song to record? I don't know. I mean, I need to. I'll record that then for you. That'll be. Maybe we'll put it on the new record.
Yes.
Well, hey, and guess what? We just recorded it.
So. No, well, there you go.
RealLifeRealMusic.com. Stealing bottles from my dad. That's a good song. That's fun.
Thank
man.
You. Yeah.
I like that.
It's still my dad's favorite song.
So your brother's older, younger, what?
I got an older brother.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So you blamed it on him, basically.
No, I mean, I took the blame as well, you know, because there was times where, like, when I was a senior in high, he's a year older than me, so when I was a senior in high school, he was already a freshman in college, and bottles were still going missing somehow.
Yeah, gotcha. All right. Fair enough. Have y'all had a good time tonight? Enjoyed this show? Okay. We do have time for a few more.
Okay.
And so, yeah, why don't you just pick two or three more you want to play for us? And
let's do that.
My favorite Radney song of all time? All right. Every afternoon at 5 o'clock, I forget all about you. There ain't nothing about this honky-tonk to remind me we're through. And I can put off going back to that old empty house you swore you'd never leave. From the loneliness you handed me, well, I can get a brief reprieve. From here until closing time, it won't matter, you're gone. I can fill up my emptiness, maybe make it on my own from now till they lock the door. Put the chairs up and sweep the floors. You won't even cross my mind here until closing time. Well, the good old days are good and gone since you left without me. If I could figure out where we went wrong, well, maybe I'd be free. These ties that bind my foolish heart just won't let me start my life again. Then I wouldn't need this lonesome bar where I come to pretend. From here until closing time, it won't matter, you're gone. Memory won't break my heart, but I can make it on my own from now till they lock the door. Put the chairs up and sweep the floor. You won't even cross my mind from here until closing time. Well, every afternoon at 5 o'clock, well, I forget all about. Great.
Okay. I got a text request that at least one of your last two songs be in Spanish.
Okay.
So let's do two more. Let's do two more. One in Spanish, one in English.
Okay.
Eso es mijo.
Es mijo, yeah. Let's see. Let me do thank you.
Sorry to play two sad songs back to back, but that's what we're doing. Actually, if y'all want something a little bit more uppity, I can do. I just realized I got one song I didn't play. Y'all want some? All right. I call this my. I wrote this song for Waylon Jennings, and then it dawned on me that he passed away a long time ago. So I just been stuck singing it. But here's one that I wrote. It's called. What is it called? It's. She Can't Be Found. This morning with a terrible pounding in my head, with an empty whiskey bottle lying beside me in my bed, next to a letter from my baby. Oh, and this here's what it read. She said, I'm tired of your ways, boy, so I packed up and I left town. I did my best to love you, but time after time you let me down. And don't you come looking for me, boy, 'cause once I'm gone I can't be found. That's what she said. Now, she can't be found. No, my sweetheart done left town. Yeah. I don't know what I'm gonna do now. My sweetheart can't be found. Now I'm singing sad love songs down at some dusty old saloon, just to thinking about that woman has got me howling at the moon. That girl is sweet as an angel and hotter than the month of June. Now it's 2 in the morning and I'm all drunk and all alone. And I've tried to call that woman about a dozen times now on the phone. I hear her voice, but all she tells me is leave a message at the tone. Can you believe that now? She can't be found. No, my sweetheart done left town. Yeah. Well, I don't know what I'm gonna do now, 'cause my sweetheart can't be found. That's right. My sweetheart can't be found. I don't know what I'm gonna do now, 'cause my sweetheart can't be found. Not now, now.
Yeah. Have y'all had a good time with us tonight? Thank you guys for being such a great audience. We're going to let William take us home with one more. Remember to check it out on Real Life Real Music. We'll be here every night. I got Mason Lively tomorrow night. We got Kevin Fowler a couple days from now and Dalton Domino. So we'll be doing this show every night this week. If you've enjoyed the format tonight, come back and hang out with us. And we'll put some other guys in this chair over here.
Thank y'all so much.
este amor apasionado anda todo alborotado por volver. Voy camino a la locura y aunque todo me tortura, sé querer. Nos dejamos hace tiempo, pero me llegó el momento de perder. Tú tenías mucha razón, me hago caso al corazón y me muero por volver. Y volver, volver, volver a tus brazos otra vez. Llegaría hasta donde estés, yo sé perder, yo sé perder. Quiero volver, volver, volver. Sabor. Nos dejamos hace tiempo, pero me llegó el momento de perder. Tú tenías mucha razón y hago caso al corazón y me muero por volver. Y volver, volver, volver a tus brazos otra vez. Llegaría hasta donde estés, yo sé perder, yo sé perder. Quiero volver, volver, volver.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. William Beckman.
Kyle, thank you so much. God bless y'all. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you, guys. This is Real Life Real Music. We'll be back tomorrow night. Thanks for being here. We'll see you next time.